He just gave me the clue. Okay. I'm live now. When love comes knocking. No, wait, I'm starting backwards. No, I'm starting backwards. Woke up this morning. I woke up this morning with my mind. Walking and talking with, come on in, friends, front seat, stay, or second right here. Walking and talking with my mind, stay on spirit. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Well, I'm singing my song, yeah, singing my song with, good morning, Wendy, stay, you're moving good. Whoa, 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 spirit, singing my song. Hoo-hoo, stay. Come on, spirit, singing my song with my mind. Stay on, spirit. Ooh, you guys are lit. Come on. I want you to take this energy, and if you're open to it, I want you to turn to your neighbor and say good morning, happy day. Share a love, a high five, a little twist in the hip. Hello at home, we see you. Well, I woke up this morning, yeah. Woke up this morning, I love these smiles. Of that service. If this is your first time, we welcome you. I want to let you know every Sunday is different. We have artists, we have different musicians, we have different speakers. We are the full meal deal for your better living, happy life, and good beingness. I want to welcome Neil this morning. I want to welcome you this morning. Today is a good day, yes? It's a great day. I'm feeling it too. We got an AGM after service today. That stands for Annual General Meeting. And I know that all of us are members and we're going to be able to vote. And even if you did not become a member, that's cool because you can still participate and you can be here. We're providing lunch for you. I hope you're hungry. It's going to be a beautiful morning. It's going to be a beautiful event. It's going to be a beautiful celebration of our Center for Spiritual Living. There's a couple things I get to share. Reverend John La Palma. Yay! He's coming next week. He's one of the candidates. Yeah, come on. He is a candidate for our senior spiritual leader. And he will be presenting a talk next week that is called Seize the Day. And following that talk, he's going to facilitate a workshop called I Don't Know How, But Spirit Does. There will also be pizza served that day. So tick after church today, annual general meeting. Tick to participate at church next week. We have a guest speaker, maybe a future. Yes. And pizza. Check, check. Neil should also add, could he have a microphone, please?
I should also add, I think, I don't know if we've decided this for sure, but I think the workshop is just going to be a love offering. I don't think there's that correct? Okay, so there's no actual fee for it, but there's a love offering.
Neil runs our webpage now and keeps me in check. He does a great job. Put your hands together for him. It's a beautiful thing. I'm grateful. I appreciate it. And there's something else that I'm incredibly, profoundly grateful for that we had no idea was happening behind the scenes, Reverend Corrine Crockett and board. Neil and I, all of us, are part of a greater organization, centersforspiritualliving.org. There are over 400 centers across the entire globe. After 21 years of service, Neil and I were recognized, and we won the Arts Award. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. We were profoundly grateful and still are. It wasn't even on our radar. What I want to tell you is this award we receive is really yours. Because every Sunday morning for the last 21 years, you open your hearts to us. You invite us to come and shine and be who we are. We've never had to be anything less than who we are on these stages. And so this award is yours, and we are deeply, profoundly grateful for that. Well, Reverend Melody, you should come and do an opening treatment, and then we should do a song, and then we should get right to it, because today is a good day, yes? This is Reverend Melody Bailey.
So, this is the treatment for today, and I speak it for myself. If the words resonate with you, please take it for yourself. For what I know is there is one power and one presence, one divine givingness of that love that is the source of all things. And that I choose to call God, but it is the power back of everything that there is. It is fully present here now in each and every one of us, because there is only one thing happening, and that is the system of God. Knowing that this divine lovingness, creative power flows into, through, and as everybody, what I know is that there is a wonderful expression of creation happening here now, in life, in expression, that there is love in all relationships. There is health as the source of my being. And there is abundance. So what I know is this creative, success, loving relationship experience, this vibrant health and this abundance is who I am and who I choose to be and consciously am aware of. For I step forward in life with this as the source of my being, with consciousness of love expressing through me, as me, for me, and therefore rippling out to everybody I come in contact with, whether in person, online, through an email, however, there is always that love, that expression of God flowing through. This is who I am, this is who I choose to be. And knowing this, I step forward into this love with joy, and I embrace it, I embody it, and I let it be who I am, and I consciously choose that every second. With the gratitude that is welling up inside, I know this truth. I have spoken this truth, and the infinite law of mind that has heard these words is now impressed with these words. And it is manifest in this moment here. And now, and so it is.
Reverend Melody, thank you for that beautiful opening treatment as we root ourselves in that foundation. This song is by Bruno Mars. It's called Count on Me. Sing along. If
you ever find yourself stuck in the middle of the sea, I'll sail the world to find you. If you ever find yourself lost in the dark and you can't see, I'll be the light to guide you. Find out what we're made of when we are called to help our friends in need. You can count on me like 1, 2, 3, I'll be there. And I know when you need me, I can count on you like 4, 3, 2, you'll be there. That's what friends are supposed to do, oh yeah. Ooh, ooh, ooh. If you're tossing and you're turning and you just can't fall asleep, I'll sing a song beside you. If you ever forget how much you really mean to me, every day I will remind you. Oh, find out what we're made of when we are called to help our friends in need. Well, you can count on me, like I'll be there. And I know when I need you, I can count on you, like you'll be there. 'Cause that's what friends are supposed to do, oh yeah. Ooh, ooh. You'll always have my shoulder when you cry. I'll never I'll be there. And I know when I need you, I can count on you like 4, 3, 2, you'll be there. 'Cause that's what friends are supposed to do, oh yeah. Woo, 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 woo. You can count on me, 'cause I can count on you.
Thank you, Neil. Here's what I want you to walk away with this morning, friends. Here's what I want you to walk away with today, and I'm going to say it, and your humanness will instinctually give you reasons and insert all the reasons why not. I'm going to share something with you, and I just want you to have an open mind. I just want you to give yourself space to absorb it, receive it, use it, believe it, claim it. Deal? Don't forget, thoughts are going to pop into your head to bombard our deal, our pact. Okay? Just breathe into it. Here it is. You are worthless, and you deserve absolutely no good in life. I know you're thinking, where's Rev Barb? Have you lost your mind? That's completely contradictory to everything that we espouse in this teaching, right? Let me ask you this. Is your mind making up reasons why you do, in fact, deserve good things in your life? Is your humanness fighting that statement right now internally? I told you it would. Don't you want to get up and walk out? Please don't. There's more. There's always more. There's always more. Don't do that. Or did you believe me and resign yourself? She's right. And you're talking in your internal ER voice. She's right. I suck. I don't deserve one single thing that's good. Did the statement frighten you? Did it surprise you? In fact, friends, I don't want you to walk away with the phrase that you don't deserve anything good in your life. want you to walk away with discernment. That even in the discomfort of that statement, that even in the discomfort of that statement, you remember exactly who you are. That even when someone, me, the world, a family member, a workmate, the news, the media, is throwing something at you, that you remember who you are. Was anyone uncomfortable with that statement? Well, discomfort is the least of our concerns. And that's the title of today's talk. Deepak Chopra said, awakening is not changing who you are, but discarding who you are not. You all know darn well what I said was a lie. You are, in fact, deserving and worthy of whatever your heart desires. But when you believe someone or something is invading your sacred space, i.e. you, your sacred body temple, we must ignite our power and lean into our truth of who we are. While I was away in Kenya this past month, I was reminded, tapping back into my mind that the meaning of life is just simply to be alive. It's just to be alive. It's so plain. It's so obvious. It's so simple. And yet everyone is rushing around in a great panic as if it were necessary to achieve something beyond themselves, even if it means believing in lies. When we master truth in self, when we master truth in God, truth in others, trust in life, we begin to see our personal shift. Yes? Maya Angelou said, "You will never face many defeats in you will face many defeats in life, but never let yourself be defeated." Say that again. That's right. That tells me you're feeling it. Here's what I really want you to walk away with today. The sense of feeling of self-power, self-love, as we embark on this transformative journey together. Are you willing to embrace any discomfort and unlock your full potential? Nobody wants to answer now because they're not sure where I'm going to go. I tricked you once. Don't hesitate. I won't do it again. Are you willing to embrace your discomfort and unlock your full potential? Yes. The choice is yours. It's yours. Step outside your comfort zone, embrace the discomfort, and unleash the extraordinary person that resides within you. Embrace your discomfort today and watch your life as it takes on new dimensions of growth, achievement, and fulfillment. Here we grow. How many of us have ever experienced fear? Liar, liar, pants on fire. How many of us have ever experienced fear? Yeah, I know. How many of us have made decisions based on that fear? I refuse to let fear make decisions for me. Claim it and say it with me. I refuse to let fear make my decisions for me. Life is full of uncomfortability. Is that a word? Discomfort. It's full of discomfort. And you heard Reverend Mel last week say that we come into this life, we are born out of the safe, beautiful, warm womb, and we come ripping, delivering into the cold, terrifying chaos, and it's our very first experience of divine discomfort, yes? Life is complicated. Not even can be complicated. Life is complicated. Our humanness is very complex. But it is also magnificent. And if we let it, we can sprinkle grace and glory and goodness all around it. This month is Black History Month, and we're exploring lessons learned from being uncomfortable and how putting down the need to be comfortable allows space for transformation. So I'm going to get right to it. Some of you may know, and others may not. My mom was black and my dad was white. And the life that we lived brought me to who I am with you today. Now, because my mom was black, and it's Black History Month, it would make sense for me to share stories with you about my mama. But this week in my meditation and my prayer work, what came to me was that I'm going to share with you about my dad. He was white and Irish. I want to share with you about my dad because we're talking about discomfort. And because the lives that we lived were filled with a lot of fear, discomfort. And what I learned from my dad was resilience. You see, as a black kid growing up in a predominantly, not even predominantly, all white neighborhood, I learned firsthand the universal pain of exclusion and oppression. And at one point in Edmonton, where I grew up, we were the only black family, along with relatives, of course, living in Edmonton, and any other black person that I saw in Edmonton, I was related to them. I started you off with discomfort this morning because recognizing that being uncomfortable, it really is the least of our concerns. It allows us to get back to the business of love because, friends, we have a lot of love work to do. Discomfort is an inherent part of our human experience. For me personally, it generated a potential for personal growth, learning, flexibility, motivation, resilience, and adaptability. I always say I can fit in. Rather than avoiding discomfort, my parents encouraged me to develop effective coping strategies and embrace as a catalyst for positive change lessons for me. They taught me from the very beginning who I was, where I came from, and so that when others told me their opinions, not just like teachers and coaches and things, I'm talking family members and neighbors because they had their own biases and their own fears, saying things to me like, you don't deserve this. Just like I said to you, you're not worthy of this. You can't do this. This isn't for someone like you. I learned how to fight, not only with my fists, which I did, but they taught me to fight and use my mind and turn my heart inward toward myself, because we all know when you love yourself, you can love others, right? They equipped me. But I want to share with you about my dad, because my dad was a badass. Or maybe I should say mischievous. Revs, can I say badass in church? It's too late, I just said it. Okay. Ass is a body part, okay. He was a middle child and a family of three boys. He was rebellious from the beginning and going against the grain from the very beginning. He didn't follow the usual or the familiar path of others or even what he was expected to do. He did not conform. You don't think my dad had fear? But my dad had discipline. And what I mean by that is he was a cellist and he played the cello from the age of three. He turned out to be lead cellist in North America for over 25 years. He had discipline to know who he was and what his personal abilities and capabilities were. He played first cello in symphonies all over the world. He was passionate about his music. It was who it was his everything. He put his heart, his soul, his time, his energy, and his love into music. He knew exactly who he was. Talk about mischievous and not following the rules. He even lied about his age so he could get into World War II. He had a commitment to his country. He fought in the Korean War. All of the discipline, discernment, the character, the passion, the little bit of crazy, I come by it honestly, I'm just saying. It gave him power to know exactly what was important to him and what brought him joy, what gave him love and commitment to self. And it turned out he was going to need that because he was going to marry a black woman in the 50s. Just to give you an idea of my dad's stubbornness, perseverance, and determination, I heard this story while growing up as a kid. When my dad was playing with the San Francisco Philharmonic, he had a Norton motorcycle. Have you ever heard of any collector? Yeah, a Norton, really cool bike. I've seen pictures of it. So picture my dad driving across the Golden Gate Bridge with his cello strapped on his back. Very rock star, I'm just saying. He did something that some might call crazy or insane, but I think he wanted more and perhaps tired of the race. He drove his bike after driving across the bridge off a side road on the other side of the bridge. He got off, kept his cello on his back, stepped off the bike, left the bike, and started walking. Just started walking. Whatever prompted him to do that, I don't know. I don't even want to guess. But when he started leaving one segment of his life, it propelled him forward into the next. You don't think my dad had fear? Now, this was huge, because imagine, my daddy came from a privileged background financially. His family was incredibly wealthy. His dad was a doctor. His mom was a renowned pianist. And they lived in neighborhoods in Calgary that were opulent, and even to this day are still very opulent. He leaves San Francisco, comes back home to Alberta, meets and falls in love with a black woman who was 20 years his junior. Mm-hmm. Let me hear you say, mm-hmm. I'm just saying, they had 7 children, mixed race, mulatto kids. His family disowned him because of this. Her family disowned her because of this. And they were on their own. You don't think my dad had fear? I'm talking about my dad during Black History Month. And I am aware, incredibly aware, of the importance of claiming this month for our heritage, our story, our past, and our future. I'm not naive, and I'm not negating Black History Month at all. But if I'm black, and my dad is part of my history, here's the thing. My dad never took away any of that from me. He actually helped us build it and never allowed us to forget who and whose we were and where we came from. Ever. It's hard for mixed race couples. Even today, trust me, let alone the 50s, the 60s, the 70s. Today, my husband is one of the strongest men I know. He reminds me a lot of my dad, his qualities of love and immense strength and courage. But my dad was the strongest man and most intelligent man that I ever knew, and he was my first example of how a man should love a daughter. Protect her, spoil her. I was a true daddy's girl. It drove my brothers and my sister crazy, but I loved doing it. Sidebar, you know, I used to think that my dad had magic. I would never call my dad in the middle of the night if I was ill. It would always be my mom. But if I was thirsty or I was needed comforting, I would call my dad. And my dad would come in, and I used to think that his index finger was magic. And he would put it under the water when I would ask for water, and I was convinced that it made it ice cold. His finger made it ice cold, and I quickly learned he was checking to see if it was cold, right? I learned that. But to me, it was magic. How does he do that? In the middle of the night, if I awoke, and as I said, I would never call my mom unless I was sick, my dad would come in after a long evening of playing the symphony, with playing with the likes of Ray Charles, Procol Harum, and so many more. And what I know as a parent today, he would drag his butt out of bed, come to my room, sit on the edge of my bed, hold my hand, and say, "What is it, daughter?" He would comfort me, make me feel safe and loved. "Daddy, I'm thirsty." He'd say, "Okay." And off he would go to get me a glass of water, and I would yell out, "Don't forget to use your magic!" And he would come back, and he would give me the water, and he would say the Lord's Prayer with me. He would tuck me in, and off we would both go. It's in this memory I can understand, once again, the greatness of God always reveals itself in simple things, yes? Yes. You see, what he was doing was so much more than just bringing me water. You know, I hear it. He was teaching me how a warm, safe, trusting love can truly feel. He was exhausted, I'm sure, but he never made me feel less important than anything. So because of his behavior, expressing unconditional love, I started gaining confidence with myself from the first male love that I ever had, my dad. He was raising 7 black children. You don't think my dad had fear? Friends, I can honestly tell you that it wasn't easy. I remember a time I heard stories that when my parents rented a home, they moved in 1 week and they had to move out at the end of the month because somebody bought the house so that they couldn't rent it, so that they were out of the neighborhood. My dad was the strongest man I know, and he taught me resilience. Neil, sing a song and talk about this song. Ladies and gentlemen, this is Neil Clausen.
Okay. Thanks. So Barb asked me to pick a song for Soul Food Sunday, and I picked this one, which is a little unusual for church, but the reason I picked it is because the lyrics are kind of vague, but if you read them, it really is about the futility of war. Nobody wins. And that includes race wars, black, white, the fighting. Who wins? Nobody wins. So if you ever wondered what the song is about, that's what it's about. But the other reason I picked it is because her dad is on the recording. He plays on the recording. And he's very prominent because he's the first cellist. The song requires a full orchestra, which I don't have. But imagine him. It's a great recording. Procol Harum, Conquistador. Conquistador, your stallion stands in need of company. And like some angel's hallowed brow, you reek of purity. I see your armor-plated breast has long since lost its sheen. And in your death mask face, there are no signs which can be seen. And though I hope for something to find, I can see no maze to unwind. Conquistador, a vulture sits upon your silver shield, and in your rusty scabbard now the sand has taken seed. And though your jewel-encrusted blade has long been plundered, still the sea has washed across your face and taken of its fill. And though I hope for something to find, I can see no place to unwind. Conquistador, there is no time, I must pay my respects. And though I came to jeer at you, I leave now with regrets. And though the gloom begins to fall, I see there is no, only all. And though you came with sword held high, you did not conquer, only die. And though I hope for something to find, I could see no maze to unwind. And though I hope for something to find, I could see no maze to unwind.
Thank you.
Neil Clausen, thank you for that honor. That's so good. That's so good.
Do y'all know that song? You heard it. Go home and listen to it, and you hear that dunk, 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 dunk. Those cellos. That's her dad.
That's my dad. and there's so much more, but we won't do that right now. But there's so much more. My dad taught me resilience. Thank you, Neil. And resilience is a vital aspect of human psychology and well-being, friends. When we view resilience as a dynamic process of interaction of various cognitive, emotional, and behavioral therapies, we begin to change. And he taught me that resilience is not just about bouncing back from adversity or dealing with being uncomfortable, actually. It involves the ability to adapt and cope effectively with challenges and changes. My daddy showed me that when we emphasize the importance of developing adaptive cognitive strategies, that we can manage and navigate stressful or difficult situations, that no matter what the circumstances, our lives can thrive. Here I am. Some things that he demonstrated to me daily was things like problem solving, putting all the ducks and geese in a row. My husband does that for me. How to regulate emotions no matter how distressed we may feel. My husband does that for me. In the earlier days, when there was no social support, we only had each other. And as I aged and as I grew, I began finding meaning. And believe it or not, even growth in the adversity. And it's led me here. Here I am. You see, even though there was stress and unimaginable pressure, fear, and discomfort in our home, amidst the chaos, we always had love. We always had love. And when we acknowledge that experiencing positive emotions such as joy, gratitude, optimism, all of those things, that can enhance the resilience of buffering the impact of stressful situations and adversity. Positive emotions broaden an individual's cognitive and behavioral repertoire, since we're talking about music, promoting creativity, flexibility, and resourcefulness when faced with challenges. Because my dad was my dad, he taught me to reframe adversity. He taught me how to find silver linings and extract valuable lessons from difficult experiences. And that's not to say I didn't fight, and I'm talking physically fight, because he taught me that too. I'm just saying, I'm black and Irish, you don't want to tick me off. You just saw a piece of growth that I still need to do and work on. Don't forget, he was a soldier, he was a fighter, and he taught us how to fight. But he also had the capacity to challenge negative thoughts, and he taught us that too. He actually taught us to adapt to new mindsets and view setbacks as opportunities for growth and learning and kick some butt. And I'm saying, some serious life butt kicking. That's why when I say he was a badass, he kicked some life butt to thrive and teach us how to do the same. And it's no wonder why I resonate with the science of mind, because the science of mind recognizes that resilience as a multifaceted process influenced by adaptive coping strategies, positive emotionality, flexibility, like I said, adaptability, social support, compassion, self-compassion, mindfulness. And by understanding and cultivating these factors, friends, we develop resilience, and we can bounce back from adversity and thrive in the face of these challenges, just like I said. So resilience is not a fixed trait, but a skill that can be cultivated, and it empowers individuals, you and me, to navigate life's ups and downs with strength and adaptability. So I'm going to sing a song that my dad played with Ray Charles. And Ray Charles is the best. And it's Black History Month, so let's celebrate him too.
He also played with Nat King Cole. Nat King Cole's pretty good too.
Nat King Cole was great. But when my mom would go to the concert with him, the symphonies, and after the concert, I'll tell this story, Ray Charles, my dad came out to find my mom, couldn't find her anywhere, and he found her in the back green room with all of Ray Charles' band having a good time, I'm just going to say. And instead of Little Miss America, that's the song, he sang Little Miss Canada.
And I can't stop walking.
much. I heard you singing at home. I heard you singing. Now's my favorite part of Soul Food Sunday. Ladies and gentlemen, it's my honor to share the Arts Recipient Award nominee and winner, Neil Gordon Clausen.
Thank you. Thank you. Barb told a bit of her history here this morning, and as hard to listen to as some of it was, she actually told you the sanitized version. And I don't mean that in a funny way. She's actually told me some stories of the names that she was called and the things that were done to her that I'm naive. I grew up in a white, privileged, middle-class neighborhood. I'm so naive. And I just had no concept. And why? Why? Because she has a different color of skin. That's the only reason. That is the only reason. It's because her skin color is different. That's it. That's why she had to suffer. Now, as most of you know, we were in Africa a couple of weeks ago for a conference. And during the conference, we drove through the Rift Valley. Now, I don't know if any of you are familiar with the Rift Valley, but the Rift Valley is where they discovered Lucy. And I'm not talking about Lucy from Peanuts. I'm talking about Lucy was the skeleton of the first recognized humanoid that was not, like, that was vaguely human. It was Lucy. She was a female. She was black. Now, made me wonder, why do we have different skin colors? Well, different skin colors are simply the product of evolution. And so do you know why there are many different skin tones in the world? There's not just black and white. There's every gradient in between. It's something called convergent evolution. So different people in different parts of the world all evolved different colored skin at the same time. And you know why? Not so that they could live in a better house. Not so that they could get a better education or live in a better neighborhood. Skin tone evolved because of vitamin D. That's it, vitamin D. Too much of it causes cancer. Too little of it, we can't live. So in southern climates where there's a lot of sunlight, they've adapted a darker skin tone to block the vitamin D. As you move north to where you have less sunlight, we have evolved whiter skin so that we can absorb more vitamin D. That's it. That's the only reason we have different skin color. And you know what doesn't recognize skin color? Is the brain. If you cut open skulls all the way around the world, our brains are going to be exactly the same. They're not going to be white. They're not going to be black. They're not going to be Chinese. They're not going to be Asian. They're not going to be South American. They're just going to be a brain. That's all they are. Now, you've heard it said before that we only use about 10% of our brains. Have you heard that before? That's actually just one of those myths. It's not really true. Somebody just said that, and it just got repeated over and over again. We actually use 100% of our brains all the time.
Oh, no, really?
Yeah. Yeah. Although sometimes Barb might wonder if I'm actually using my brain. But it's true. And the brain is an incredible thing. I read this thing. So one tiny piece of your cortex, which is about the size of a grain of sand, that's small, can hold about 2,000 terabytes of information. Now, how much is 2,000 terabytes of information? That is enough to store every movie ever made, plus the trailers, every copy of Science of Mind ever purchased, and every lecture by Ernest Holmes, and you know how he likes to talk. That's a lot of information. So when we have discomfort, the type of discomfort that Barb is talking about, it's our brain that eases that discomfort or reinforces that discomfort. See, the brain doesn't see daylight. It doesn't have senses. It interprets senses. So it's interpreting what your senses are telling you, and it's just a perception. That's all it is. It's not reality. Senses are colorblind. So therefore, they can change. And the point of it, I'm going to leave you with this thought, is that, because our brains don't have color, they're all gray, doesn't matter what culture you are, and because we can use them to change, change your thinking, change your life. What I want you to take away from this, after hearing from Barb's story and about discomfort and about the things you can change, when you change your thinking to change your life, you're also changing your thinking to change the life of others. And that's what I'll leave you with today. Thank you very much.
Neil Clausen. Thank you, Neil. Imagine the exhilaration of stepping into the unknown and facing our fears head on and conquering challenges that once seemed insurmountable. By embracing discomfort, we open the doors to a world of endless possibilities and untapped potential, yes? It's in these moments of discomfort that we will discover, friends, what we are truly capable of. I wouldn't be here if it wasn't for my dad and my mom's willingness to continue to walk through discomfort every single day. We cannot let fear hold us back. Instead, let's see it as an opportunity to broaden our horizons and awaken us and expand our perspectives, yes? Embracing discomfort, it fosters intellectual growth. It fuels our curiosity. It allows and helps us to do and be flexible and open-mindedness to have new ideas and possibilities. Embracing discomfort is not just about personal growth, though. It's about a driving force, like Neil said, motivation and achievement for everyone. Every person in my life who has ever said no, every person in my life who has said, you can't, that's not for you, you shouldn't do that, they became my fuel. They still do. They still do. Anyone who attempts to have disbelief from or distracting me from my full potential or tries to present obstacles to keep me from reaching my goals or part of my dream, they are my propelling forward. That fuel, that gas. The most successful individuals in history, they embraced discomfort. Years and years ago, decades ago, I was at a conference, Association for Global New Thought, and I'm pointing to myself here because I love the saying so much that I had a shirt made. Do you remember when we used to be able to press things on your shirt and you could do whatever you want? And it said, well-behaved women rarely make history. And I wore that shirt for a long time. I wore it right out till the letters were peeling off. Well-behaved women rarely make history. I'll say it again. This is Black History Month. And in a world full of uncertainty and rapid change, resilience and adaptability are more crucial than ever, family. They're more crucial than ever. And by willingly stepping forward into discomfort, we build resilience that is required to bounce back from our setbacks, those things that are adverse, and we need to face that adversity head on and thrive in the face of challenges. Spiritual family, as we embrace discomfort, we find ourselves equipped with the tools to navigate life's twists and turns with grace and confidence. We can, we will, and we are overcoming the troubles and difficulties that we have allowed to enter our lives when we remember that love is the creating and sustaining presence with all. When we remember God loves, moves, gives, and exists as me, then I begin to eliminate the anger, the resentment, and that divine nature flows freely through me. And I have eliminated fear. When I believe that infinite mind is forever creating and conceiving those new ideas, and that the infinite law is forever producing new forms and iterations, when I believe this, the instant I have a new thought, a new form appears. Say it with me. No longer will I choose to live a mediocre life. No longer will I choose to live a mediocre life. I just want to say that even though he's been gone for a long time, I just want to say thank you, Daddy. I think that being in discomfort was the least of my dad's concerns. Will I live or die if I fight in the war? Should I leave my Norton motorcycle and start walking? Should I marry a black woman? Nah. My dad always led with love. Always. Always led with love. And he was very funny, too. So during this Black History Month, I celebrate my white dad because I couldn't have been me without him being him. Here's what I want you to walk away with today. I'm going to say it, and your humanness will instinctually insert all of the reasons why not. I'm going to share something with you, and I want you to just have an open mind. Give yourself space to absorb it, use it, believe it, claim it. Deal? I'm not tricking you this time. Don't forget, because your thoughts are going to try and bombard our deal, our pact. So just breathe into it. Here it is. You are deserving and worthy of all of the love and joy that the universe has to offer. Carl Jung said, "The privilege of a lifetime is to become who you really are." And what a privilege it is to be me, and what a privilege it is to see you be you. Friends, today I encourage you to step so far outside your comfort zone that you forget how to get back. I'm not telling you it's going to be easy, but I'm telling you it will be worth it. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Bless you, Reverend Melody.
Okay. So I'd like to have the ushers come forward, but I do have a couple of things to share with you, first of all. Right after service, we will need to take some time to reset up for the
want to go to the back table where Reverend Diane will be seated and register for the AGM. For all of those who are members, she'll need to check you off as being here and being able to vote for the AGM. So please do that after service. Also, we continue to collect Nature's Fair receipts for our 3% club. We get 3% back on all receipts, so please submit those regularly. I send them in every quarter. And now is our time of offertory, and we do have some affirmations that we share each time to bring our consciousness on the abundance that it is that we have. So I would like you to repeat after me. I know that my giving blesses and multiplies all that I am, all that I have, and all that I give and receive. And together we say, I do give eternal thanks for the abundance that is mine to share. Back to Barb.
Thank you, Reverend Melody. Have you had a good morning? Are you inspired? Are you uplifted? Well, then my job is done. Up on your feet, friends. We're going to say yes to more love, more joy, more peace and harmony. When love comes knocking at my door, what you going to do? I say yes.
Oh, yeah.
When love comes dancing across my floor, I say yes.
Oh, yeah.
When I need a little more of what I'm looking for, I know that I am blessed. When I say yes, just say yes. You gotta say yes. Here come the freedom. The freedom's calling now. When freedom comes knocking at my door, I say yes. I say yes. And when freedom comes dancing across my floor, I say yes. I say yeah. And when I need a little more of what I'm looking for, I know that I am blessed. When I say yes, just say yes. You gotta say yes. Here come the world. The world's a calling now. When the world comes knocking at my door, tap, 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 I say yes. Oh, yes. And when the world comes dancing across my floor, oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. When I
I know that I am blessed when I say yes, just say yes. You gotta say yes. Here comes the love's a calling now. When love comes knocking at my door, tap, tap, tap. What are you gonna say? We say yes, always yes. And when love comes dancing across my, what will we say? Let's dance, love. I love you. When I need a little more of what I'm looking for, I know that I am blessed. I said yes, uh-huh, just say yes. All right, we gotta say yes. Let me hear ya. Just say, well, I heard you say, come on and say, we're gonna do it one more time. I hear you, I hear you, I love you, I love you. Yeah, go forth and shine the love and light that you are. Peace and blessings.